Welcome up. This episode is effectively a workshop for researchers on how to do a systematic literature review. But first, I will need to make a theoretical introduction on what are systematic reviews and what are they used for. So, just to warn you, if you want to skip this part, you can go directly to the video chapter dealing with operationalization. You can do this through the specific links in the description. But I would suggest you hear me out on why I believe systematic reviews are the way to go for several reasons. Systematic reviews emerged in the early 1990s in clinical biomedical research in the UK, but since then have moved to other fields. Producing the review means offering all researchers interested in studying the topic the means to understand what has been already done and in which direction should future research be oriented. This is the traditional understanding of what a classic literature review does, except it does not. It only promises to do it because it lacks the certainty of having reviewed all relevant studies on a given topic. This last statement is reinforced by the fact that several studies published in relevant journals and included in many systematic reviews, also in those conducted for my PhD research, for example, are very similar, adding very little to the discussion. Clearly, this is not only the outcome of flawed literature reviews, but also the effect of overpublishing in a peer pressure generated by the increasing requirements of the academic industry. The best way to understand the efficiency of the different approaches to literature is offered by a comparison with the sampling of a population. For the purposes of this video, I'm assuming you know what sampling a population involves, but I will deal with this in a different video workshop. A traditional literature review is not dissimilar from the snowball method used to create a sample. It can be a very useful tool, but it is time-consuming and it does not guarantee the result. Besides its inherent flaws, in general, sampling methods do not tell anything about the population. The classic literature review is therefore problematic at its start, because the process is potentially never-ending, leaving the researcher with the uncertainty of not having completed a fundamental task for which will be blamed at a later stage. At the opposite, a systematic review starts with the operationalization of the topic in a few relevant keywords. If the topic is corruption, introducing the keyword in one of the relevant databases of social sciences shows the size of the population under scrutiny, in this case all the academic literature ever produced on the topic corruption. In a systematic review, this phase is called identification. Critiques of traditional reviews are becoming increasingly common, as highlighted in Doing a Literature Review, Traditional and Systematic Techniques, as shown in Trends for Open Access to Publication by the European Commission. Another major limit lies in the fact that less than only half of published studies are open access, and this condition affects the quality of literature reviews of researchers from different contexts. In other words, a researcher from a good university will have access to more literature than a colleague from a worse one. In sum, a systematic literature review offers certainty of the outcome, it is more scientific in Popperian terms because it is easily reproducible and transparent, it is psychologically advantageous for the researcher because it clarifies the literature scope from the beginning. Finally, a systematic review treats literature as data and not as a measurement competition. Oh, you've not read that? How insulting! No, it's not that. It's about data. Now, how do you start a systematic review? First, you need access to a scientific library such as Scopus or the Web of Science of the Institute of Scientific Information. Usually, Google Scholar is not enough. So, if you can't have that, you won't be able to do a systematic literature review. The first step consists in the operationalization of the topic or research question. If you don't have one, of course, you cannot start. In the previous chapter, video chapter, I was making the example of corruption. You can search for studies on corruption, but the number of results you will receive are immense. You will then need to narrow down your search in consideration of your preferred interest. Maybe a geographic point of reference will be useful. Do you want corruption in general? Then you can try corruption theory. Your goal is to convert topics and research questions to two or three keywords that you can input in your library browser. This is the phase of identification. The phase of identification is the one that requires more reflection because the researcher has not yet put any real effort on the search and has the opportunity to change idea, project, or population. In this phase, it becomes clear whether the research is feasible or not in consideration of the resources at disposal, namely time to read and access to the literature. This is when the researcher can decide to narrow down the topic, reducing the size of the population indirectly. If the topic is corruption in Uganda, the operationalization of the topic will produce two keywords, corruption and Uganda, and the database will show an inferior number of entries. At this point, the researcher should proceed in creating a few criteria that will be necessary to identify the sample of the study, namely the literature to read. While these criteria are conceived to create the sample, they may have the positive side effect of giving a more precise picture of the population. An example is the criterion all studies should be in the realm of social sciences. On the one hand, this choice reduces your sample of studies, on the other hand, enforcing it allows the researcher to get rid of studies originally included in the population due to the inherent ambiguity of the keyword used. For example, simply introducing corruption in Scopus, a researcher will obtain studies not relevant for the purpose of the search, such as corruption of digital images. The creation of these predetermined criteria is what makes the sampling of the literature potentially unbiased. In practice, the population and sample are never perfect, but the process is verifiable and falsifiable, and hence scientific in Popperian terms. Other examples of criteria are the years of publication, the language used for the research, and the number of citations. There are published systematic reviews that include only studies with more than 50 citations. This, of course, leads you to review only studies with an impact, but maybe only the older ones, because something published this year won't likely have many citations. When the criteria are established, the process moves from identification to screening. This is when the researcher judges critically the titles and abstracts of the pool of results informed by the predetermined criteria. If we want to put this in perspective based on my experience, judging titles and abstracts of, say, 400 studies is not that much. It can take you up to 3 hours, and it is less of half a day of work. But it saves you months of roaming aimlessly for studies. For example, I have Uganda as an interest, but one article that fell into my basket only mentions Uganda, to focus then on a case study on Brazil. In this case, my predetermined criterion helps me to exclude a study that should have not been there in the first place. Hey, I'm taking a little break from the video to sponsor you my Buy Me a Coffee page. If you found this video useful, you could buy me a coffee for as little as 1 euro. The link is in the description. Cheers! The next phase is eligibility, the moment for the researcher to read the full text of the remaining studies. In a systematic review, the researcher starts reading an article aware that it will be useful, while in a traditional review, the reading may be unproductive. In fact, even if a study reveals to be not what the title and abstract promised it to be, the initial criteria may determine its exclusion from the final sample of studies. Systematic literature reviews usually terminate with a full list of studies included in the sample. This list, along with the description of the most important studies of the sample, is what will help future researchers to have a full account of the literature on a particular topic at a given time, reading just a few pages. Another advantage of systematic reviews that I did not mention earlier on is that while systematic reviews are useful for other scientists, normal literature reviews are not, because they are used by anybody else than you. That is why systematic reviews can be published. Finally, for the completeness of a systematic review, grey literature, namely non-academic or unpublished studies, can further complete the scope of the search to relevant documents neglected by academic databases. This is where Google Scholar and, in limited occasions, the normal Google browser can be effectively useful. Final suggestions. Use a reference manager to help you sort out references, Mendeley, Zotero, whatever you prefer. look for other systematic reviews on the same topic if there are any. It saves you time, of course. Play with keywords and excluding principles until you're actually convinced. And if you're doing a study involving different topics, you might need to do multiple but likely smaller systematic reviews. I am sure that reading will be way easier in this way. Literature reviews can change your initial perspective on a topic and even change your research question. Maybe simply because the question you posed had already been answered. You can also analyze bibliographic details, useful to understand your field and the publishing industry, but even the most used methodologies and what debates are occurring in your field. As a qualitative researcher, the results of papers I retrieved could not be compared. But if you are a student of medicine or pharmacology, maybe you can use a meta-analysis of the study's results to see the effectiveness of treatments. In fact, this was the original purpose of systematic reviews. And even nowadays, in medicine and pharmacology, instead of doing more experimental treatments, scientists group results from several studies to deduct the effectiveness and safety of a drug, say, a vaccine. Curious, where did I get this example from? I'm understanding politics. Thank you for watching.